I'm Leon Russell. I am the president of the International Association of Official Human Rights Agencies, headquartered in Washington, D.C. We are an association of agencies that enforce civil and human rights laws across the country.
So at the National Law Center on Homelessness and Poverty, we have worked with a variety of state and local agencies, including state departments of education, especially on homeless education issues. Homeless children have the right to go to school here in the U.S., even though they don't have a fixed address. But a lot of school districts, because they base their decisions about residency on whether you have a residence, they don't allow homeless kids to access education. And so we've worked a lot with state and local groups to help promote that right.
We know the numbers of homeless are reaching 70,000 in our county alone, and that's been a high figure for many decades. And it's time that we understood what is it that homeless people endure day to day in terms of crime. And by doing that tracking of crime, and we'll be the first in the nation to do this, we'll be able to be more cognizant and work harder to eliminating homelessness. We'll be able to recognize, if we're not providing them housing at this moment, at least are we providing them protection and security? How can we improve upon that? How can we ensure that their basic rights as human beings are protected?
At the Rights Working Group, what we envision with a reformed U.S. Civil and Human Rights Commission is the opportunity to tackle some of the problems that our member organizations on the ground are facing. So for example, right now we have a campaign against racial profiling, and we're doing a series of field hearings around the country collecting the testimonies of people who have been racially or religiously profiled. And I think it's a wonderful opportunity to work with local and state human rights commissions who, again, have a lot of information and resources about the kinds of problems in their communities. So we hope that by working together on a campaign to promote a U.S. Civil and Human Rights Commission, we can all work together to advance on some of the specific challenges that our organizations are facing.
I envision that with a reconstituted U.S. Commission on Civil and Human Rights, working collaboratively with state and local human rights commissions, the 200 nonprofit NGO organizations that are part of the leadership conference working together, we will have an amazing network across this country.
The U.S. government has a lot to learn from what happens at the local level. It's at the local level that we have best practices that can be shared across the country and on an international level. We have not only enforced discrimination law, but we're working for equity in areas to address sexism, to address racism, to address all the other areas that are pertinent to international human rights treaties.
The U.S. government benefits from our agency's monitoring of social conditions and monitoring relationships and dynamics in communities, as well as our advocacy and implementation of equitable and safe standards at the local and state level.
For far too long, the United States has just been giving a high-level view of its obligations, but it hasn't looked at what's actually going on the ground, what happens in cities and counties and states across this nation. Our partnership will offer an opportunity for a complete picture of what's happening in the United States.
We think this will be a great step forward in helping the U.S. in its compliance with international covenants, and also in pushing the government to ratify covenants it is not yet a party to.
And finally, they have an obligation to take steps to address past discrimination and policies that not only have a discriminatory intent, but also a discriminatory impact.
One of our most fundamental human rights is to be free of hate violence. No one should be subjected to violence, threats, denigration, or any kind of prejudice or discrimination because of the color of their skin, their ethnic group, the country they come from, their sexual orientation, their religious beliefs, their gender or gender identity or disability. No one should suffer discrimination because of their age, immigration status, socioeconomic status, or any other arbitrary characteristic. We've had to fight for hate crime laws, but we need to continue to work to make sure communities know about those laws, report hate crime, and that those laws are respected and enforced. And what's key is to prevent hate crimes from happening in the first place. That means investing in the things that prevent hate violence, like acting quickly to intervene when violence occurs, improving police-community relations, and applying the research on human behavior, intergroup dynamics, and brain science. For example, we know that integrating human relations, such as social and emotional learning curriculum, into our classrooms and campus culture can make a huge difference in terms of not only reducing campus bullying and harassment, but giving students a sense of belonging that allows them to fulfill their academic potential. The most important strategy we need to focus on is to get at the root causes, to advocate for youth development programs, decent paying jobs, affordable housing, good schools, and health care for everyone, so that we can change the conditions that perpetuate stress, inequality, and violence in our communities, so we don't have to keep on paying for more police, prosecutors, and prison beds.
Start now.